here, but I'm hearing none of the meeting.
Okay.
So, Flanette?
What? No, I don't do that shit. Talking. Couple of cookies, huh? Right. Yeah. All right. How's everybody doing? Excellent. Woohoo. Okay, fantastic. It's 4:03. We're a little tardy. I apologize. We're going to call to order the Wednesday, February 5th, DRCOG board work session. So I guess number two is public comment. Is there anybody who would like to do public comment today? Seeing none, we will close public comment and be on item, which is briefing on HB 20-1151 expansion of authority for regional transportation improvements. I will throw it to Director Rex for a little preamble before we get to Ron.
No, thank you, sir, very much, and appreciate we got good attendance today, and hopefully we'll get a few more coming here in a minute. I'm still trying to understand why no one wants to sit next to Kevin. That's somewhat troubling. I don't know. Don't take it personal, Kevin. No, so our first item.
Very good.
That's right. I'm for annexation.
So our first item this evening, as the chair mentioned, is a discussion about House Bill 1151. We knew it was coming sooner or later, so we wanted to have a very frank and open conversation about this bill with you today. I just want to say this just before we begin. I mean, I personally, or DRCOG staff, we're not trying to sell you guys on anything with regards to this bill, but what we do want to do, we want to provide as perfect information as possible for you all to make an informative decision when we do take a position on this, probably at our regular board meeting in February. If you don't know, this bill has been calendared for March 4th, March 4th in the Transportation Committee. So I think it would be timely if we were to take a position on this bill at our February meeting. Again, I hope we do have a good conversation about this today. You know, this bill in itself, you know, if this is about you guys, this is for you. So if this is somewhere we want to go and we'll have that discussion, that's fantastic. I have asked Ron just to walk through the bill itself and just talk about what is actually in the bill. So we'll have a very comprehensive conversation about that. I would like to have a conversation with the board about, you know, some of the pros and cons, maybe some concerns that you have with the bill, the opportunities that may exist to improve the language in the bill that we'd be more than willing to take forth to the drafters, as well as Metro Mayor's Caucus is having some discussions later on this month with their Transportation Committee, and we'd like to at least have some kind of consistent message with them, or at least, if nothing else, share some of our concerns and comments with them. So with that, I'm going to turn it to Ron, and hopefully we can have a good conversation.
Thank you, Executive Director Rex. Good afternoon, everybody. Ron Papstorff, Director of Transportation Planning and Operations here at DRCOG. Thanks for the chance to speak to you. I'm going to try to just hit the highlights of what we believe the bill does as it's introduced, and obviously any bill can change as it works through committee hearings, and we don't, I think at this point, fully know what the future holds for this bill. It may become a vehicle for other things. I think we're all trying to digest what exactly it does and any opportunities that there might be to tweak the bill language, improve the language, and I think that's where Doug and I wanted to have a conversation with the board this afternoon to start to get some initial feedback. So I'll start with just a high-level a little bit of what was in the staff report for today's meeting, summarizing what the bill does. So as you all know, there is existing statute language, the Regional Transportation Authority statute, that allows the formation of regional transportation authorities through agreement among multiple jurisdictions, local jurisdictions. This bill basically expands the ability to create those authorities to transportation planning organizations in order to exercise the powers of a regional transportation authority that are already existing in current statute. It defines a transportation planning organization, or TPO, as a metropolitan planning organization or a rural transportation planning organization. And I want to note here that Dr. Cog is actually both of those. Dr. Cog is both a metropolitan planning organization for a portion of the Dr. Cog boundary that does not include the rural eastern parts of Arapahoe and Adams County and does not include Gilpin or Clear Creek County. So the MPO boundary is the urban part of Dr. Cog as designated by the federal government. However, the entirety of the Dr. Cog boundary, including those areas, is designated by the state as a transportation planning region. So conceivably, in the case of Dr. Cog, using either of those hats could, if this bill passed in its current form, elect by the board to exercise the powers of a regional transportation authority. The key powers of an RTA are to fund transportation improvements, and the three mechanisms that are defined in current statute that RTAs are allowed to use that would be extended to TPOs if they elected to utilize this are an annual motor vehicle registration fee up to $10 a year, a visitor benefit tax up to 2% of the price of overnight accommodations. That requires voter approval because it's a tax, not a fee, and a sales or a use tax or both.
Don't Peck.
Hi, Director Peck. At a rate not exceeding 1%, again, with voter approval. So any use of either of the tax options that are included in statute obviously require voter approval. The annual vehicle registration fee would not because it's a fee. So how would a transportation planning organization elect to exercise the powers of an authority as included in this draft bill? So the language lays out, and most of this is repetitive of the existing RTA statute, and some of it's been tweaked in order to reflect sort of the dynamics of a TPO electing to do it rather than an RTA being created through a cooperative intergovernmental agreement among more than a couple of jurisdictions. So the TPO would have to hold at least two public hearings. The TPO, its board of directors, you, in the case of Dr. Cog, would adopt a resolution authorizing itself to exercise the powers of an authority. That resolution would have to specify the transportation systems to fund. So which transportation systems, which projects, that would all be worked out in the resolution. The resolution would have to specify those things. And then the resolution would specify the boundaries of the territory within which the TPO was authorized to exercise the powers of the authority. So the bill language as introduced and written in our interpretation of it is that if a TPO, if this bill passed, elected to exercise the authorities of, exercise the powers of an authority through that resolution, could define the boundaries as the entirety of the boundary, whether you're wearing the MPO hat or the transportation planning region hat, or a subset, a smaller boundary. And so I think the language gives some flexibility there depending on the will and interests of the members of the board of directors. After adopting the resolution, a certificate would be filed with the director of the Division of Local Government in the Department of Local Affairs, and then you would have to provide copies of the resolution for comment to CDOT, to a transit district created in statute, which the only one in the state is RTD, and any overlapping public highway authority. So in the case of the Denver metro area, E-470, Northwest Parkway, for their review and comment. And they have certain time frames in which to provide comment back on the resolution, and then there's a time frame for the groups to sort of negotiate if there are any issues that need to be worked out between those different agencies. And then finally, once all those steps were taken, assuming that the resolution included a tax proposal to fund the transportation systems that were included in the resolution, then there would be a referral to the voters within that boundary to approve or not approve the tax to fund those improvements. So just a couple of additional items, a couple of other provisions that are in the bill. So again, the boundary of the authority has to be specified in the resolution, but does not have to include the entirety of the TPO area. Non-member jurisdictions, so if they're within that boundary, if there are certain jurisdictions within DRCOG that aren't actual members of DRCOG, they cannot be forced into the authority without approval of their governing body. So I think there's a few cities or towns that are within the DRCOG boundary today that aren't actually members of DRCOG. They could not be forced to be within the boundary unless their town council or city council said, voted affirmatively that they wanted to be in it and agreed to be in it. Likewise, for areas outside the boundary, you can have conversations about whether the boundary wants to extend beyond, but again, that requires approval of the governing body of that jurisdiction that you're contemplating. There's also a hold harmless section in the legislation. I know that's been important to a lot of folks in the development of the bill, that specifies that the Transportation Commission and CDOT cannot take any TPO funding into account when they're determining the amount of state transportation dollars to allocate within the boundaries of that TPO. So if a region decided to utilize this tool and raise local revenue for transportation improvements, the state, CDOT, and the commission could not sort of disadvantage that area because they raise local revenue in terms of determining how. And the way the statute sort of enforces that is it requires CDOT to provide evidence in its annual budget submittal to the legislature that the proposed allocation of state transportation funding within the boundaries has not been reduced in any way. I will take this opportunity to maybe kick off part of the discussion. One of the things that we've identified as a potential issue, while the overall language of that whole harmless probably works pretty well, the fact that it refers only to state transportation funding might be a bit of an issue because half of CDOT's budget is federal transportation dollars. And so we might want to be a little more expansive in that hold harmless clause to make sure it deals with all of CDOT's transportation investments, not just the state portion of their transportation funds. With that, that's my brief summary of the bill. I think we'd be happy to have any answer any questions about the bill as we understand it today.
Director Atchison.
Yeah, one of the things that, and this was a very lengthy discussion, if you were not at Metro Mayor's for 2.5 hours this morning, the concern I think some people are saying, well, what if I have a community that doesn't want to be in it? I have to be in it. Opt out. That activity is already covered in the bill. We were talking about it earlier with the DRCOG staff, is our interpretation from them, and some of us had looked at this again, even though you are living in a DRCOG boundary, Nicholas says, I don't want to be in it. He has the option to opt out. And that's before we ever send the declaration to the voters. So if that voters pass it, then Denver is out. They don't have to be a part of it. I think that's a piece that some people have said, well, my community may decide they want it. Whether it's a county or a municipality, either one, under the current interpretation of what's proposed in 1151, you do have the opt-out option.
Yeah, I was just going to ask Ron. So there's a couple different places in which, but Ron, you want to just go?
Sure.
It's specific in section 8, we believe. Now, I will say this as Ron is scrolling to that section. We have reached out, well, we're going to reach out to the drafters to make sure our interpretation of that is correct, but then we'll share that with you when we do get it. And if I know you had something to say.
I would suggest maybe a little nuance to Director Atchison's. Our staff interpretation of the bill is not that there's a clear opt-out. So I don't personally, I'm not an attorney. I wasn't involved in drafting the language, but my interpretation of the language isn't that a particular jurisdiction has an affirmative right under the bill as introduced to opt out. What the bill does appear to do, and it's covered both in the definition section on page 2 of the bill, which I've got up there, it's the boundaries of the authority, allows the TPO to specify the boundaries in which they elect to exercise the powers of an authority, and then I'm going to scroll quite a bit down. I think it's on page 15 or 16 of the bill.
It's 16, Ron.
Thank you. And section 8.
15.
You're steering me wrong.
Yes, section 8.
We're gone.
Oh, that's in-house.
So then section 8, paragraph 1, speaks to the board of the transportation planning organization may authorize itself to exercise some or all of the powers and authority set forth in part 6, which is the RTA statute, within the region or any portion of the region. So there's not an affirmative opt-out for any one jurisdiction to just say, I'm not in, but the negotiation of a boundary and the way the bill's introduced and written in our interpretation of it, there's flexibility for the board adopting the resolution to define the boundaries. So the negotiations about if certain jurisdictions were in or out and drawing that boundary would be part of the resolution discussion. And I think that's an issue for all of you to think about and talk about, is that strong enough? And do you sort of trust each other to negotiate fairly about what should be in or out of a boundary in that resolution discussion? Or is there a need for sort of stronger language for a specific opt-out? Because technically, my interpretation of the bill language as introduced is that a majority of the board passes the resolution. The resolution includes the boundary, and conceivably, a majority of the board could overrule one jurisdiction's interests and say, appreciate that you object to being in, but you're in.
And I don't have the same interpretation from a couple of other people looked at it. So this is one reason that, as Ron's saying, they're going back to the drafter. They need more specific indication so that this question gets answered. But I don't think we'll have that for at least a week.
So we have Director Partridge, Director Shaw, and Director Jones, and with Director Brockett.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Chair. Director Jones, that was one of my questions too. Thank you for asking that, because I just want to first start my statement off with, whenever it comes to legislation, you know, that's law. A legislator's job is create a law. But what I see is when we're looking at what I'm going to just call legislative fixes, or when we're looking to fix the bill, those really come down to policy. Policy comes the executive, or you know, the branch of government where it falls under the local control for us. But so one thing I'm always cautious about is throwing too many amendments in a bill to fix it, because then it becomes policy. And I had this argument with Commissioner, former state rep Mark Waller in El Paso County. I said, now you get to set policy, you just don't set law. We have that ability as mayors, council people, commissioners, to be all three branches. So that's why I'm always a little cautious about how much do we put into a law. So let's say that there is an opt-out situation. I just raise the questions for us to think about, because I think it's for us, if this would become a law and we would want to come forward, how do we handle the policy questions in a resolution? And with that, I would say, let's just say a community does opt out. Well, somewhere we'd have to figure out, if it did pass within, let's just say the whole MPO or TPO, that a community opts out. But if we're going to decide how do we divvy this up, well, we kind of divvied up the last TIP process through the sub-regional. Well, how do you do fair share or a pro-rated share to say, well, here's a community in this sub-region that's out. Well, do we pro-rata that in, out? So I think there's a lot of things that I think we have to ask these questions. Now, am I interested in getting that into law? No, because that's a policy question for us to decide in this room if it ever come up. And that is just one of many things I think we have to think about with this, because it's careful what you ask for, the unintended consequences. Because as we know how hard it is, first of all, to figure out with our own sales policy, but what if we decide, well, this does need a legislative fix? What it takes to go back and do a legislative for a fix to a bill is very difficult, and then additional things get put into that. So I just think I want us to really think this through. There's a lot to this. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Director Shaw.
Thank you. I guess my question kind of ties into this, because I'm trying to figure out who would opt out, whose decision it would be to opt out, and the vote would only apply to the money. So the people who had been opted out by someone else wouldn't really get a chance to decide on whether they wanted to be in or out. They would just not vote at all, right? I mean, because the money would already not be assessed upon them if they were opted out. But it's almost like there might be some people who see a benefit to being part of this, even if their leaders had felt it's right to opt that area out. I don't know. I feel like that could be a little sticky.
I'm not sure if there was a question there, Director Shaw, or not, it sounded like a little bit of a question. So let me take it.
I'm talking
so
to
I will
myself.
I will say, under the current RTA statute, that's exactly how it works. It's a coalition of the willing. The Pikes Peak Area Regional Transportation Authority has, I don't know, 6 local government members. It doesn't cover the entirety of the Pikes Peak area, and it was just those local jurisdictions that were willing to sort of sign on to the agreement. And so it is those ultimately those governing bodies that decided to join in through that agreement to form that RTA and then send the question of funding to the voter. So in that way, I'm not sure this is much different. The decision under the way the statute of this bill is written is that it's the board of the TPO that gets to decide, and you all represent your local jurisdiction. So instead of each of your town council, city council, county commission sort of deciding as a body, it's you all collectively here around the table deciding on the form and the structure of the resolution and ultimately passing that resolution. So that replaces that sort of agreement piece that's in the RTA statute. And so if, for instance, there were negotiations among the board of a TPO to define a boundary that was less than the total because there were some jurisdictions that didn't wish to be in, and that was what the board agreed to in terms of defining that boundary in the resolution and passing the resolution, that's not, in my mind, I don't think that's much different than sort of the negotiations that go on among jurisdictions in more rural areas, smaller geographies that utilize the existing RTA statute to sort of decide who's in and who's out. And then the voters don't, in those areas that are outside that boundary, they don't vote on the tax because they're not paying the tax.
So what, if I could have a follow-up, so what happens, let's pick on Denver again, just because they've already been picked on.
That's right.
But let's say that that they opt in and their voters vote no on the money. What, and let's say everyone else, for sake of argument, says yes, we'll pay these fees. So I get that, which is why it's a really good example to call you out on this. But how would that work? I mean, or must it be the entire MPO who's opted in is the total vote, and it doesn't matter what your region says? Okay, thanks.
Director Shaw, you answered your question. Once the boundary is drawn, the question of a tax goes to the voters within that boundary, and it takes 50% plus one to approve a tax.
Okay.
regardless of where those voters come from, within that boundary.
Thank you.
You're good? All right. Director Jones.
Thanks. We're really wrestling with this bill and trying to fully understand it. Thanks for the explanation. I feel like I've learned already some new things about it. I would say that the language in the bill now does not contain a jurisdictional opt-out. That was my reading of it, and that's our legal reading of it. And if it's not clear, that's not good drafting. So at a minimum, I would suggest that we include such a thing. That would be one of my recommendations. The other is the bill, and you and I spoke about this moments ago, contains a reference to a supermajority vote, but I could find no legal reference in the statute to that. I would think that if Dr. Cog wanted to do something like this, it would be a big vote, and we would want a supermajority. And so that, I think, should be explicit in there, that any resolution to create an RTA should have a supermajority so that you can maximize the buy-in. And just, I guess, one of the things that we're wrestling with in Boulder County, and, you know, we've tried to be team players. We've voted along with Denver for Prop 110, Prop CC, trying to bring statewide transportation dollars. Would still love to see a statewide solution. Don't know if that's going to happen. I wouldn't bet large sums of money on it, but so we're at the point where we're thinking that it's time for us to start looking locally about generating the revenues we need. So we're in active discussions with our municipalities about whether or not we want to do something at the county level. So, A, I just wanted everybody to know that's the context in which we're looking at this bill, which means we would potentially, if we were to decide to go to the ballot and our voters did approve transportation sales tax increase for Boulder County, then we would probably want to opt out of the Dr. Cog because we don't want to ask our voters to pay, double that amount because we, you know, there's a limit. So that's one of the reasons. But I guess one question I would have for Ron or whomever is, why wouldn't a county just choose to increase its own sales tax on its own with its municipalities and be in full control of how those dollars are spent? There's no IGAs, there's no nothing, you just go to the ballot with your voters. That's what we're looking at, and I need to hear the rationale for why it would be better to wrestle through a resolution with everybody at this table on, you know, what can the money be spent on, that, this, that, and the other. And so if you have some insight, or if anybody else has some insight on that, that would be great.
It's a bit of a policy question, but I would suggest that one reason you might think about that is because while a local jurisdiction or a county might decide to seek voter approval for funding for improvements within their jurisdiction or jurisdictions, there's a whole lot of need around the region that probably your businesses and residents need and would benefit from that you wouldn't be able to invest in. And likewise, your taxpayers in your jurisdictions would be paying that tax to make improvements within your jurisdiction that other users of the system within Boulder County wouldn't be contributing maybe their fair share towards. And so I think maybe there are real local needs that some local jurisdictions need or counties need, but maybe there are sort of big regional transportation needs that this region would benefit from, that really benefit many jurisdictions and many parts of the region that collectively you sort of need to address collectively, not individually. So that might be one way to look at that.
and I'm hearing none of the meeting.
Okay.
Ms. Lynette?
What? No, I don't do that. Talking. Public cookies, huh? Right. Yeah. All right. How's everybody doing? Excellent. Woohoo. Okay, fantastic. It's 4:03. We're a little tardy. I apologize. We're going to call to order the Wednesday, February 5th, DRCOG board work session. So I guess number two is public comment. Is there anybody who would like to do public comment today? Seeing none, we will close public comment and be on item, which is briefing on HB 20-1151, expansion of authority for regional transportation improvements. I will throw it to Director Rex for a little preamble before we get to Ron.
No, thank you, sir, very much, and appreciate we got good attendance today, and hopefully we'll get a few more come in here in a minute. I'm still trying to understand why no one wants to sit next to Kevin. That's somewhat troubling. I don't know. Don't take it personal, Kevin. No, so our first item.
Very good.
That's right. I'm for annexation.
So our first item this evening, as the chair mentioned, is a discussion about House Bill 1151. We knew it was coming sooner or later, so we wanted to have a very frank and open conversation about this bill with you today. I just want to say this just before we begin. I mean, I personally, or DRCOG staff, we're not trying to sell you guys on anything with regards to this bill, but what we do want to do, we want to provide as perfect information as possible for you all to make an informative decision when we do take a position on this, probably at our regular board meeting in February. If you don't know, this bill has been calendared for March 4th in the Transportation Committee. So I think it would be timely if we were to take a position on this bill at our February meeting. Again, I hope we do have a good conversation about this today. This bill in itself, you know, if this is about you guys, this is for you. So if this is somewhere we want to go and we'll have that discussion, that's fantastic. I have asked Ron just to walk through the bill itself and just talk about what is actually in the bill. So we'll have a very comprehensive conversation about that. I would like to have a conversation with the board about, you know, some of the pros and cons, maybe some concerns that you have with the bill, the opportunities that may exist to improve the language in the bill that we'd be more than willing to take forth to the drafters, as well as Metro Mayor's Caucus is having some discussions later on this month with their Transportation Committee. And we'd like to at least have some kind of consistent message with them, or at least, if nothing else, share some of our concerns and comments with them. So with that, I'm going to turn it to Ron, and hopefully we can have a good conversation.
Thank you, Executive Director Rex. Good afternoon, everybody. Ron Papstorf, Director of Transportation Planning and Operations here at DRCOG. Thanks for the chance to speak to you. I'm going to try to just hit the highlights of what we believe the bill does as it's introduced, and obviously any bill can change as it works through committee hearings, and we don't, I think at this point, fully know what the future holds for this bill. It may become a vehicle for other things. I think we're all trying to digest what exactly it does and any opportunities that there might be to tweak the bill language, improve the language, and I think that's where Doug and I wanted to have a conversation with the board this afternoon to start to get some initial feedback. So I'll start with just a high level a little bit of what was in the staff report for today's meeting, summarizing what the bill does. So as you all know, there is existing statute language, the Regional Transportation Authority statute, that allows the formation of regional transportation authorities through agreement among multiple jurisdictions, local jurisdictions. This bill basically expands the ability to create those authorities to transportation planning organizations in order to exercise the powers of a regional transportation authority that are already existing in current statute. It defines a transportation planning organization, or TPO, as a metropolitan planning organization or a rural transportation planning organization. And I want to note here that DRCOG is actually both of those. DRCOG is both a metropolitan planning organization for a portion of the DRCOG boundary that does not include the rural eastern parts of Arapahoe and Adams County and does not include Gilpin or Clear Creek County. So the MPO boundary is the urban part of DRCOG as designated by the federal government. However, the entirety of the DRCOG boundary, including those areas, is designated by the state as a transportation planning region. So conceivably, in the case of DRCOG, using either of those hats could, if this bill passed in its current form, elect by the board to exercise the powers of a regional transportation authority. The key powers of an RTA are to fund transportation improvements, and the three mechanisms that are defined in current statute that RTAs are allowed to use that would be extended to TPOs if they elected to utilize this are an annual motor vehicle registration fee up to $10 a year, a visitor benefit tax up to 2% of the price of overnight accommodations. That requires voter approval because it's a tax, not a fee, and a sales or a use tax, or both.
Joan Peck.
Hi, Director Peck. At a rate not exceeding 1%, again, with voter approval. So any use of either of the tax options that are included in the statute obviously require voter approval. The annual vehicle registration fee would not, because it's a fee. So how would a transportation planning organization elect to exercise the powers of an authority as included in this draft bill? So the language lays out, and most of this is repetitive of the existing RTA statute, and some of it's been tweaked in order to reflect sort of the dynamics of a TPO electing to do it rather than an RTA being created through a cooperative intergovernmental agreement among more than a couple of jurisdictions. So the TPO would have to hold at least two public hearings. The TPO, its board of directors, you, in the case of DRCOG, would adopt a resolution authorizing itself to exercise the powers of an authority. That resolution would have to specify the transportation systems to fund. So which transportation systems, which projects, that would all be worked out in the resolution. The resolution would have to specify those things. And then the resolution would specify the boundaries of the territory within which the TPO was authorized to exercise the powers of the authority. So the bill language as introduced and written in our interpretation of it is that if a TPO, if this bill passed, elected to exercise the authorities of, exercise the powers of an authority through that resolution, could define the boundaries as the entirety of the boundary, whether you're wearing the MPO hat or the Transportation Planning Region hat, or a subset, a smaller boundary. And so I think the language gives some flexibility there depending on the will and interests of the members of the Board of Directors. After adopting the resolution, a certificate would be filed with the director of the Division of Local Government in the Department of Local Affairs, and then you would have to provide copies of the resolution for comment to CDOT, to a transit district created in a statute, which the only one in the state is RTD, and any overlapping public highway authority. So in the case of the Denver metro area, E-470, Northwest Parkway, for their review and comment. And they have certain time frames in which to provide comment back on the resolution, and then there's a time frame for the groups to sort of negotiate if there are any issues that need to be worked out between those different agencies. And then finally, once all those steps were taken, assuming that the resolution included a tax proposal to fund the transportation systems that were included in the resolution, then there would be a referral to the voters within that boundary to approve or not approve the tax to fund those improvements. So just a couple of additional items. I guess, a couple of other provisions that are in the bill. So again, the boundary of the authority has to be specified in the resolution, but does not have to include the entirety of the TPO area. Non-member jurisdictions, so if they're within that boundary, if there are certain jurisdictions within Dr. Cog that aren't actual members of Dr. Cog, they cannot be forced into the authority without approval of their governing body. So I think there's a few cities or towns that are within the Dr. Cog boundary today that aren't actually members of Dr. Cog. They could not be forced to be within the boundary unless their town council or city council said, voted affirmatively that they wanted to be in it and agreed to be in it. Likewise, for areas outside the boundary, you can have conversations about whether the boundary wants to extend beyond, but again, that requires approval of the governing body of that jurisdiction that you're contemplating. There's also a hold harmless section in the legislation. I know that's been important to a lot of folks in the development of the bill, that specifies that the Transportation Commission and CDOT cannot take any TPO funding into account when they're determining the amount of state transportation dollars to allocate within the boundaries of that TPO. So if a region decided to utilize this tool and raise local revenue for transportation improvements, the state, CDOT, and the commission could not harm, could not sort of disadvantage that area because they raise local revenue in terms of determining how. And the way the statute sort of enforces that is it requires CDOT to provide evidence in its annual budget submittal to the legislature that the proposed allocation of state transportation funding within the boundaries has not been reduced in any way. I will take this opportunity to maybe kick off part of the discussion. One of the things that we've identified as a potential issue, while the overall language of that whole harmless probably works pretty well, the fact that it refers only to state transportation funding might be a bit of an issue because half of CDOT's budget is federal transportation dollars. And so we might want to be a little more expansive in that hold harmless clause to make sure it deals with all of CDOT's transportation investments, not just the state portion of their transportation funds. With that, that's my brief summary of the bill. I think we'd be happy to have any answer any questions about the bill as we understand it today.
Director Atchison?
Yeah, one of the things that, and this was a very lengthy discussion, if you were not at Metro Mayor's for 2.5 hours this morning, the concern I think some people are saying, well, what if I have a community that doesn't want to be in it? I have to be in it. Opt out. That activity is already covered in the bill. We were talking about it earlier with the Dr. Cog staff, is our interpretation from them, and some of us had looked at this again, even though you are living in a Dr. Cog boundary, Nicholas says, I don't want to be in it. He has the option to opt out. And that's before we ever send the declaration to the voters. So if that voters pass it, then Denver is out. They don't have to be a part of it. I think that's a piece that some people have said, well, my community may decide they want it. Whether it's a county or a municipality, either one, under the current interpretation of what's proposed in 1151, you do have the opt-out option.
Yeah, I was just going to ask, Ron. So there's a couple different places in which, but Ron, you want to just go?
Sure.
It's specific in Section 8, we believe. Now, I will say this as Ron is scrolling to that section. We have reached out, well, we're going to reach out to the drafters to make sure our interpretation of that is correct, but then we'll share that with you when we do get it. And if I know you had something to say.
I would suggest maybe a little nuance to Director Atchison's. Our staff interpretation of the bill is not that there's a clear opt-out. So I don't personally, I'm not an attorney. I wasn't involved in drafting the language, but my interpretation of the language isn't that a particular jurisdiction has an affirmative right under the bill as introduced to opt out. What the bill does appear to do, and it's covered both in the definition section on page 2 of the bill, which I've got up there, it's the boundaries of the authority, allows the TPO to specify the boundaries in which they elect to exercise the powers of an authority. And then I'm going to scroll quite a bit down. I think it's on page 15 or 16 of the bill.
It's 16, Ron.
Thank you. Section 8.
15.
You're steering me wrong.
Yes, section 8.
We're gone.
Oh, that's in-house.
So then section 8, paragraph 1, speaks to the board of the transportation planning organization may authorize itself to exercise some or all of the powers and authority set forth in Part 6, which is the RTA statute, within the region or any portion of the region. So there's not an affirmative opt-out for any one jurisdiction to just say, I'm not in. But the negotiation of a boundary and the way the bill's introduced and written in our interpretation of it, there's flexibility for the board adopting the resolution to define the boundaries. So the negotiations about if certain jurisdictions were in or out and drawing that boundary would be part of the resolution discussion. And I think that's an issue for all of you to think about and talk about is that strong enough? And do you sort of trust each other to negotiate fairly about what should be in or out of a boundary in that resolution discussion? Or is there a need for sort of stronger language for a specific opt-out? Because technically, my interpretation of the bill language as introduced is that a majority of the board passes the resolution. The resolution includes the boundary, and conceivably, a majority of the board could overrule one jurisdiction's interests and say, appreciate that you object to being in, but you're in.
And I don't have the same interpretation from a couple of other people looked at it. So this is one reason that, as Ron's saying, they're going back to the drafter. They need more specific indication so that this question gets answered. But I don't think we'll have that for at least a week.
So we have Director Partridge, Director Shaw, and Director Jones, and with Director Brockett.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Chair. Director Jones, that was one of my questions, too. Thank you for asking that, because I just want to first start my statement off with, whenever it comes to legislation, you know, that's law. A legislator's job is create a law. But what I see is when we're looking at what I'm going to just call legislative fixes, or when we're looking to fix the bill, those really come down to policy. Policy comes the executive, or you know, the branch of government where it falls under the local control for us. But so one thing I'm always cautious about is throwing too many amendments in a bill to fix it, because then it becomes policy. And I had this argument with Commissioner, former state rep Mark Waller in El Paso County. I said, now you get to set policy. You just don't set law. We have that ability as mayors, council people, commissioners, to be all three branches. So that's why I'm always a little cautious about how much do we put into a law. So let's say that there is an opt-out situation. I just raise the questions for us to think about, because I think it's for us, if this would become a law and we would want to come forward, how do we handle the policy questions in a resolution? And with that, I would say, let's just say a community does opt out. Well, somewhere we'd have to figure out if it did pass within, let's just say the whole MPO or TPO, that a community opts out. But if we're going to decide how do we divvy this up, well, we kind of divvied up the last TIP process through the sub-regional. Well, how do you do fair share or a pro-rated share to say, well, here's a community in this sub-region that's out. Well, do we pro-rata that in, out? So I think there's a lot of things that I think we have to ask these questions. Now, am I interested in getting that into law? No, because that's a policy question for us to decide in this room if it ever come up. And that is just one of many things I think we have to think about with this, because it's careful what you ask for, the unintended consequences. Because as we know how hard it is, first of all, to figure out with our own sales policy, but what if we decide, well, this does need a legislative fix? What it takes to go back and do a legislative for a fix to a bill is very difficult, and then additional things get put into that. So I just think I want us to really think this through. There's a lot to this. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Director Shaw.
Thank you. I guess my question kind of ties into this, because I'm trying to figure out who would opt out, whose decision it would be to opt out, and the vote would only apply to the money. So the people who had been opted out by someone else wouldn't really get a chance to decide on whether they wanted to be in or out. They would just not vote at all, right? I mean, because the money would already not be assessed upon them if they were opted out. But it's almost like there might be some people who see a benefit to being part of this, even if their leaders had felt it's right to opt that area out. I don't know. I feel like that could be a little sticky.
I'm not sure if there was a question there, Director Shaw, or not,
no,
but it sounded like a little bit of a question.
So let me take it.
I will say, under the current RTA statute, that's exactly how it works. It's a coalition of the willing. The Pikes Peak Area Regional Transportation Authority has, I don't know, six local government members. It doesn't cover the entirety of the Pikes Peak area, and it was just those local jurisdictions that were willing to sort of sign on to the agreement. And so it is those. It is ultimately those governing bodies that decided to join in through that agreement to form that RTA and then send the question of funding to the voter. So in that way, I'm not sure this is much different. The decision under the way the statute, this bill is written, is that it's the board of the TPO that gets to decide, and you all represent your local jurisdiction. So instead of each of your town council, city council, county commission sort of deciding as a body, it's you all collectively here around the table deciding on the form and the structure of the resolution and ultimately passing that resolution. So that replaces that sort of agreement piece that's in the RTA statute. And so if, for instance, there were negotiations among the board of a TPO to define a boundary that was less than the total because there were some jurisdictions that didn't wish to be in, and that was what the board agreed to in terms of defining that boundary in the resolution and passing the resolution. That's not, in my mind, I don't think that's much different than sort of the negotiations that go on among jurisdictions in more rural areas, smaller geographies that utilize the existing RTA statute to sort of decide who's in and who's out. And then the voters don't, in those areas that are outside that boundary, they don't vote on the tax because they're not paying the tax.
So what, if I could have a follow-up, so what happens, let's pick on Denver again, just because they've already been picked on.
That's right.
But let's say that that they opt in and their voters vote no on the money. And let's say everyone else, for sake of argument, says, yes, we'll pay these fees. So, I get that, which is why it's a really good example to call you out on this. But how would that work? I mean, or must it be the entire MPO who's opted in is the total vote, and it doesn't matter what your region says? Okay, thanks.
Director Shaw, you answered your question. Once the boundary is drawn, the question of a tax goes to the voters within that boundary, and it takes 50% plus one to approve a tax.
Okay.
regardless of where those voters come from, within that boundary.
Thank you.
You're good? All right. Director Jones.
Thanks. We're really wrestling with this bill and trying to fully understand it. Thanks for the explanation. I feel like I've learned already some new things about it. I would say that the language in the bill now does not contain a jurisdictional opt-out. That was my reading of it, and that's our legal reading of it. And if it's not clear, that's not good drafting. So at a minimum, I would suggest that we include such a thing. That would be one of my recommendations. The other is the bill, and you and I spoke about this moments ago, contains a reference to a supermajority vote, but I could find no legal reference in the statute to that. I would think that if Dr. Cog wanted to do something like this, it would be a big vote, and we would want a supermajority. And so that, I think, should be explicit in there, that any resolution to create an RTA should have a supermajority so that you can maximize the buy-in. And just, I guess, one of the things that we're wrestling with in Boulder County, and, you know, we've tried to be team players. We've voted along with Denver for Prop 110, Prop CC, trying to bring statewide transportation dollars. Would still love to see a statewide solution. Don't know if that's going to happen. I wouldn't bet large sums of money on it, but we're at the point where we're thinking that it's time for us to start looking locally about generating the revenues we need. So we're in active discussions with our municipalities about whether or not we want to do something at the county level. So, I just wanted everybody to know that's the context in which we're looking at this bill, which means we would potentially, if we were to decide to go to the ballot and our voters did approve transportation sales tax increase for Boulder County, then we would probably want to opt out of the Dr. Cog because we don't want to ask our voters to pay, double that amount because we, there's a limit. So that's one of the reasons. But I guess one question I would have for Ron or whomever is, why wouldn't a county just choose to increase its own sales tax on its own with its municipalities and be in full control of how those dollars are spent? There's no IGAs, there's no nothing, you just go to the ballot with your voters. That's what we're looking at, and I need to hear the rationale for why it would be better to wrestle through a resolution with everybody at this table on, what can the money be spent on, that, this, that, and the other. And so if you have some insight or if anybody else has some insight on that, that would be great.
It's a bit of a policy question, but I would suggest that one reason you might think about that is because while a local jurisdiction or a county might decide to seek voter approval for funding for improvements within their jurisdiction or jurisdictions, there's a whole lot of need around the region that probably your businesses and residents need and would benefit from that you wouldn't be able to invest in. And likewise, your taxpayers in your jurisdictions would be paying that tax to make improvements within your jurisdiction that other users of the system within Boulder County wouldn't be contributing maybe their fair share towards. And so I think maybe there are real local needs that some local jurisdictions need or counties need, but maybe there are sort of big regional transportation needs that this region would benefit from, that really benefit many jurisdictions and many parts of the region that collectively you sort of need to address collectively, not individually. So that might be one way to look at that.
I guess part of the difficulty with figuring this out ahead of time is it whether or not a jurisdiction would want to support this depends on the flavor of a resolution that Dr. Cog would consider. Would we actually spend money on regional projects, or would we 100% give it back to ourselves in the increment that we paid it in? Because I've heard the Metro Mayor's Caucus folks describe it in both ways. It does make sense of if there are regional projects that we would all want to, but it's not a guarantee that that's how we would do it. There's no guarantee that it would have to be multimodal. If it's not multimodal, Boulder County's not interested in raising funds for that. So we don't know what Dr. Cog would decide within a resolution, so we don't know if this is ultimately a good thing. So again, I'm just being transparent with what Boulder County's thinking about and wrestling with.
No, I think that's fair, and I think the point the bill is introduced is leaves it up to the board of directors of the TPO to decide those things and specify those issues in the resolution, which may get back to the earlier conversation about maybe requiring a supermajority of the board is the right approach, because those are really important regional decisions within a TPO and might give more assurance to those participating that you're going to be able to reach a agreement that everyone, but a significant majority of the board really agrees with and wants in that resolution.
Can I just add on real quick? I don't want to belabor the point, but I'll belabor the point. I think those are all very, very, very useful questions to ask with regards to this. And quite frankly, I mean, and you're right, there have been options about, you know, like local share 100% back versus some regional, large regional projects. And I think the simple fact that there are options speaks to the flexibility of this concept, which I think it should at least be intriguing to you all, because you now have the ability, obviously local tax at the county level. Now you have a regional probable option here, and of course a statewide option, which may or may not ever materialize. So you have, you know, it's another option for you to consider. And we don't know, right, that, you know, when we have that conversation, if we ever were to get in a position to actually utilize this statute, what that conversation would look like. Maybe it's not 15, 20 years down the road. Maybe there's four projects in our region that there's a gap in funding in. You know, we list those and we sunset it that 10 years or whatever to pay for those projects, and that's it. It's just four big projects around the region. I know there's one big one up your way. For example, you know, something like that, or it could be something as comprehensive as, you know, a large maintenance component to this for local communities and some regional holdback for some larger projects. You know, it runs the gamut. And I think some of the value of this is that it does have that flexibility.
So directors in the queue, we have Director Brockett, Director Flynn, and Director Williams. Director Partridge would like to talk again. That would be the second one. So right after Director Williams, I'll ask if there's anybody else who would like to do it. Yes, ma'am. And then, so let's go to Director Brockett.
Great. Well, some of the points I was going to raise have been brought up by Director Jones and Director Partridge, but just to highlight the point that if this passes at the state legislature, right, that it would enable Dr. Cog and other similar MPOs to create something like this, but we wouldn't know the form that would take, right? So you were just calling out the flexibility as potentially a positive. But also, I'm just thinking about if I'm to explain to my constituents, and they say, well, how would this work? It gets passed, and then Dr. Cog will do what? And I would have to say, I'm not sure. So, you know, we might come together, and we might pass a resolution, and we might do any of a number of different things. And I guess part of that, too, would be governance, right? Like, let's say that we do have an opt-out provision, or let's say that the board as a whole chats amongst ourselves and says, you know what, we're not going to do the whole MPO, we're going to do two-thirds of it because some people don't like it. So then does Dr. Cog kind of have two meetings a month, like the meeting of the whole MPO and then the meeting of the people who are within the funding section? Because I mean, you probably shouldn't get a vote if you're not part of the taxed area. So you probably do something like that, but I guess you wouldn't have to, right? I mean, theoretically, you could have the entire MPO voting on how the funding gets distributed, even if you weren't a part. Is that correct?
Yeah, great questions again. And we've had those similar conversations internally. And I think you're right, you know, with regards to, you know, what that governance structure would look like. And I would say one of the concerns about the bill is kind of the open-endedness of the governance side, right, of this. I do appreciate that there is language in there that suggests something about a supermajority, but there's no reference that we can find that associates something to that language. But that situation that you speak of, that there's that coalition of those that want to support do a RTA, a ballot initiative, and those not, we do see a situation in which there would be a separate subset of the board that would kind of, operating committee or something associated with that RTA, but ultimately we believe that it probably would have, those actions would have to be probably ratified by the full board, because that is deemed, Ron, do you agree with that? Maybe not. But again, I mean, I think that just speaks to some of the open-endedness that, you know, it's kind of a little squishy and uncomfortable for me, to be honest with you.
Right. So anyway, just a little bit of feedback as we're talking to the legislators that there's a certain amount of flexibility that's useful, and then it might be good to call out maybe in the governance area, maybe to put some guardrails on it in the legislation. I mean, personally, I feel like it would probably be unfair for the whole board to ratify something where only a subset of the jurisdictions were being taxed. That could go in the legislation, for example. So some things to think of.
Right. Director Flynn.
But that sounds like taxation without representation.
It sure does.
Yes. Ron, could you help me understand on page 7, what level of specificity do the drafters or the sponsors anticipate would have to be provided in the resolution for the regional transportation systems that would be provided? Because if it's a deep level of specificity, it certainly would require a huge amount of upfront work.
Director Flynn, I agree that sort of negotiating, talking about, formulating that resolution for consideration by the Board of Directors would take a lot of work. And figuring out sort of what's the right boundary, what are the right projects, what's the revenue, what revenue sharing arrangement is there or isn't there, what's the funding source that the board wants to use, and at what rate to fund those improvements. Those would all be enumerated within that resolution. The level of specificity in the resolution, I don't know. The bill language is not clear on that, and right. Quite frankly, I haven't personally gone and looked at sort of the agreements that of the, I think there's 6 or 7 existing RTAs around right. the state. I haven't looked at those to see sort
would be
of
helpful.
How much, but would certainly be willing to do that.
For instance, would we have to define just corridors where we intend to provide systems, but not a mode or a technology or funding, certainly scope?
Yeah.
Right?
I suspect so. I think the Pikes Peak region RTA, the Pikes Peak RTA specified specific projects.
That was my recollection.
Specific projects
specific.
To refer to the voters, because they thought right. that was an advantage, so the voters understood what they were going to get. And I think that RTA has been extended at least twice now with yes. a new set of projects. Right. So they've gone back and revised the agreement, added new projects as the other ones were completed.
And one other question, does the bill anticipate that the authority territory could change by resolution over time? Could it add or subtract?
There is provision in the existing RTA statute and carried through to the bill to allow amendments to the agreements and amendment to the resolution by the Board of Directors.
Okay, that could be problematic if voters in the authority area previously had approved a tax, and then the area wants to expand. I don't know how that would be handled, but
you'd have to submit that question to those voters.
Only in the territory being, okay.
Right.
Thank you.
All right, so right now we have Director Williams, Director Fahey, Director Mulvey, and then Director Partridge. Is there anybody on the phone who wants to be added to the queue before Director Partridge speaks again? Hearing none, we'll go to Director Williams.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think mine's more of a kind of a general comment. We kind of echoing Director Jones and some of the other comments here. We're wrestling with this right now, this bill right now, and we're wrestling with a broader transportation funding challenge, City, County of Denver. But that's not to say that we're not interested in seeking a regional solution. you know, I think we've talked internally about kind of if there are smaller groups that can start to have this discussion, facilitate this, because, I mean, it is, there's almost nothing more regional in its kind of impact and need than transportation, and Denver experiences that every day with 100,000 folks coming into the city to work in that. I think we're very interested in continuing to seek regional solutions and looking at different creative ways we can start to fund projects and needed projects. But we still have some pretty serious concerns about the bill as
Director Fahey.
Yes, I'm having similar concerns with Boulder County in that it would be hard for the city of Lewisville to convince our voters to vote for something because it's pretty broad, pretty ambiguous where the money is going to go and what it's going to go for. We're still feeling the burn from RTD, frankly. We still don't have fast tracks, and it's looking like 2050 maybe. And so if we could be a little bit more specific about what the money is going to go toward and where, we might be more able to pass it.
Director Mulvey.
Thank you. To the point that was made about amendments and size and scope, but my comment has more to do with the drafting and interpretation. If this resolution would allow for the creation of an RTA at any time of any size, and so ostensibly it could be done for any purpose, I would wonder whether it would not be just for what we need today, but we have to look at how it might be used down in the future and how priorities might change. And so while there might be a desire to do an RTA to do something with the I-25 corridor, north, south, or entire, then what might be the priority 5-10 years down the road? And then might somebody also say, well, we want an RTA to do something with the E-470 corridor, and then might there be some overlap? And so when we all look at that, we might want to think about how it might carefully look at the provisions to see how that might be interpreted and whether or not we have enough flexibility. And more specifically, when we do have an RTA, whoever creates one should probably think about that in the drafting of the resolution to make sure that there's flexibility, because once you create one, to go back to voters who are either within or without the boundary would create really big complications.
So we have Director Pfeiffer and then Director Partridge, finally. Director Pfeiffer.
So I wonder, so as some of you may know, I also represent us in the Region 4 TPR, and we had a good conversation a few weeks ago. And I'm curious if staff, if you've reached out to the other MPOs and see what their feelings are, because I was approached by the North Front Range MPO, who didn't seem to be very in favor of this. And they did a big study that shows that if the state would fine-tune its existing tools, adjusting small portions of license taxes and a little of the gas tax and just a little dialing in, that we could solve a statewide solution. And so not to distract from what we're trying to do here, but I think we really have one shot at something. And I'm wondering what our peer groups are thinking in the other parts of the state. I mean, I know we're all thinking about DRCOG here, but at the end of the day, this is a statewide matter, especially impacts the MPO. So you just check into that a little bit and wonder if that's growing any legs or any direction of what they're trying to do up there, because they might be a distractor to this as well, which maybe it's good, maybe it's not, I don't know. But
Director Pfeiffer, to your question, I mean, we've spoken to the other MPOs. I mean, early before this bill was introduced, as the Metro Mayor's Caucus was sort of talking about this idea, we want, look, this conversation is happening in the Denver region. Want the other MPO, the other four MPOs in the state to be aware that those conversations were going on. I know I did a presentation at the statewide MPO, at a statewide MPO meeting, sort of summarizing the concept as it was at that point among the Metro Mayor's Caucus. Didn't get a lot of pushback in terms of concern or objection to the concept. I think Executive Director Rex has had some conversations with a couple of other executive directors of other MPOs, so you might want to add to that as well. So I hadn't spoken to North Front Range about that.
Because their chair approached me very quickly after that meeting in Greeley. So I just want to make sure that, you know, talk to the others. I feel like we shouldn't work in an island on this, and making sure we see what they're doing and is there any value. Because I do agree that we have to have some flexibility in this, proposal, and this particular EMPO proposal that doesn't constrain our future, you know, elected officials to whatever flexibility they may need in the future. But the problem is being so loose can also create all the anxiety I think we have around the table now of how it's going to be used. I don't know, we're in a tough position on this because I agree with all the comments happening around the table right now, and I don't feel very comfortable that where we're at right now, this to me it's a little late in the game because I think they're going to try to push something through quick, but they're going to do it this year, right, Doug?
Well, I mean, I mean, calendared, right, for committee hearing, but I will say this, that the bill sponsor, Representative Gray, he's very open to having conversations about this bill as a vehicle for something, right? So if there's specific changes that we want associated with this bill that we ultimately can find consensus around and feel comfortable with, then his ears are wide open in that respect. I think he'd be willing to have a conversation with us. Rich, that's not overstating that, is it?
Director Partridge.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Second chance. First, address kind of what was around the state, and this was at CCI in the Transportation Committee 2 weeks ago, and it was a discussion, and frankly, I was a little surprised by the discussion. It was a very resounding no, and in the room and on the phone, it was not unanimous. There was only one vote to support all other votes, and I imagine, you know, there's over 60 in CCI. It was a resounding no. So I just wanted to report what I had heard from around the state, and you know, because many of those TPRs are headed by county commissioners, just as we are many in the room. But what I really wanted to address was, you know, kind of two issues regarding, one regarding equity and one regarding regionalism, and we've kind of struggled with this, and so Director Jones brought up, you know, why would you? So we asked that question on 110 when it came up last year amongst us, ourselves, and said, why would we want to do this? Why wouldn't we want to do this? And again, we want to be equitable, as we all do, to our constituents, but we also want to be a regional player because transportation is, it is a region. It is a statewide region, really. So we asked the question about 110. I'm sorry. We asked the question about 110. What is the effect of the 0.62 sales tax, which is what 110 was? We looked at the effect would have been what we figured would have come to Douglas County and the five jurisdictions that are wholly incorporated in Douglas County. It would have been about $14 million per year, substantial amount. Then we asked the question, what if we just raise Douglas County's sales tax portion, only Douglas County's sales tax portion, 0.625. It was over $40 million. So therefore, we struggled. We want to be equitable. We want to be regional. But I think about anybody when they're in a room would probably come up with the same conclusion. What would your voters want? But I just wanted to throw that out as a, looking at it as a whole. Mr. Chair.
Before we go to Director Jones, people on the phone, could you please mute your phone? We're getting some feedback here here at DRCOG. Thank you. Director Jones.
I too wanted to weigh in on the statewide issue. Boulder County is a part of Counties and Commissioners Acting Together, CCAT, which is a county organization, and our rural counties feel very strongly that this is a declaration of war, was how it was put, that the urban areas are breaking off to do their own thing and they're leaving the rural areas stranded because, for better or worse, rural areas are not going to be able to generate the tax basis. No, their voters would not support a tax increase, nor would they generate the volume of revenue needed to address rural transportation needs. So I do think we do have to be cognizant of the role that this bill is playing in terms of the broader statewide solution that we've all sort of been a part of. My understanding of the timing of this bill, and I guess I'd like an update from the lobbyist, is that they're moving it, but they're not going to complete it until they're using it as leverage to try to see how far they can get on with a statewide solution. And they're basically using this discussion to say to the rural areas that hate the idea of this bill, because it's viewed as Dr. Cog's vehicle for raising money and leaving everybody else out, I think is right. So they're saying to the rural areas, you have to come to the table on a statewide solution or this thing is going to pass. And so I don't think it will be through the process until the very end of the session when they've given up on a statewide solution. That's my understanding, but has anything changed on that?
Nope.
Defer to Rich.
Yes, maybe a little bit. I'll just say that a conversation I had with Matt a week or two ago, he told me he was serious about this, that he's not using it just as lever. He acknowledges that having this out there could become that or could incentivize others to come to the table. But he said, I don't want people to think that I'm not serious about doing this. He said that they were calendaring the bill for March, number one, because even though there are ongoing conversations occurring, he's not optimistic for a statewide solution. He's not optimistic that they will be fruitful. Other people have had a different opinion, have told me they have some reason to believe that there could be an agreement made, but Matt was pretty pessimistic, and so he said, that's why I'm calendaring this bill, because I want to move forward. Having said that, I think he also acknowledged that it's a pretty broad title. That may be a good thing, that may be a bad thing, because it could turn into a Christmas tree, which could please a lot of people. It could also die of its own weight. But anyway, so I think it's a little bit different perspective.
Any other questions or comments?
Jones was speaking about that her county's looking at doing a separate type of tax organization, so you could have a process. Arapahoe County is doing the same thing, and so, you know, and we also hear the state is also looking to do something. There's a big fear in our city that we're going to get all these asks at the same time and it's all going to fail. I do hear about the rural areas and that also that, yeah, you know, the state typically takes care of that, but yet the state isn't able to get anywhere. And my fear is we go to, when I go to my city, it better be a pretty good ask, since it's not going to pass. So having a lot, and I think a lot of these avenues are great. I think they all have merit, and I like the organizations being set up. But I just, when the ask gets there, it's going to be tough. It's really going to be tough.
Director Pfeiffer.
And let's just be realistic. If we're not all banding together, something won't pass, because I think we've all tried to pass something individually. Some are successful. Commerce City's one. Other cities, it goes in flames. And so when we start branching off in the Front Range, I think this was the compromise. You know, Boulder and Denver are, you know, you're famous for helping getting things passed in the state. And I think everyone knows it. And at the end of the day, for us to benefit the region or the state, we have to band together to try to get something passed. I mean, that's what it is, right? I mean, let's just call it what it is, and we need to be together. And it does hurt me a little bit to hear that Boulder would go off and do their own, because we do need you. I mean, we need to be together on this topic. And granted, you'll save your county needs, but I think a lot of people commute between Denver and Boulder, and Westminster's in the middle. And we won't, or Broomfield, but we're just not solving these regional issues, so... Let's just be considerate when we think through these.
Director Jones.
Well, and I hear that, and I don't want to be annoying by emphasizing that Boulder and Denver voted every time for a statewide transportation solution. We are team players because we agree that regional transportation system is important. But again, in full transparency, if we were talking about a DRCOG measure that was trying to raise revenue for regional multimodal projects, you might have Boulder County, but we don't know. And I've heard people say, well, it's a direct share back for pavement, or we want road expansion. That's not a Boulder County thing, right? And I've heard other people say there can be absolutely no multimodal percentage required. So we don't take it lightly to go off on our own, and we haven't made any decisions. We're just having the conversation. But I would have to go back and explain to our voters why it's better to partner up and why the vision of the region is in alignment with Boulder County. And so, again, just being transparent, would love to work in partnership with others on this for sure.
So, Ron, I have a question. It's kind of along the lines of Director Flynn, is that it sounds like we have to define a parameter, actually. Is that
Yes, that's correct. Through the resolution, that's where all those detailed negotiations would come about, and defining what the system was, which improvements to make, what revenue source to utilize at what rate, whether or not it's structured in a way that there's a portion that's shared back to all the participating jurisdictions on some formula so that they can address very specific local needs while having a regional share to focus on big regional projects that are sort of bigger than any one jurisdiction's ability to deal with. I think those are all the detailed conversations I think we talked about the last time we talked to the board about all those discussion points and decisions that would have to be discussed and decided by the board before you developed and passed a resolution.
So could there be, before we start assessing a fee, could there be a reaffirmation of the boundary before we then go forward with assessing a tax, if you will? Would that be part of this? Because it would kind of address Director Flynn's issue, and to me, there could be a significant amount of time between adoption of the tool and ratification of any kind of fee or tax. Could that be something that could be included that way? I mean, we might be in a current situation right now, Douglas County or Parker, that we're doing okay. And we would much not to be opted in because we have to make a decision now, but in 10 years things could change, in 15 years things could change when we get to this point. Could there be something like that put in this bill?
I think, Chair Dyack, that's sort of up to the direction of the board, how you want to sort of provide feedback to the sponsors of the legislation and see what they're willing to do. I might suggest that, one, the way the bill is drafted today, it would be available as an option to any TPO around the state. And so the more you start to reduce flexibility for any individual TPO to sort of structure their resolution and utilize the tool to meet their local needs, you might get less support for the bill. I think the point is if the bill passed the legislature, as it's currently introduced under this structure, ultimately the DRCOG board or another TPO board decides whether they want to utilize the tool, and it could be 2 years from now, it could be 5 years from now, it could be 10 years from now. And I think it might have been Director Shaw that spoke to you might not know when you're ready to use the tool, you might not know today how exactly you might want to structure it and what your needs were as a region. So there's a benefit probably to having that flexibility so that the board collectively makes the decision of how to utilize the tool. Director Partridge spoke to sort of maybe you don't want to legislate too tightly those bounds and reduce that flexibility. And, a lot of the conversation I'm hearing is really important, and it sort of, to me, what I'm hearing is just a straight up majority vote on the among the board to decide to do this and how to structure it probably isn't enough. That you all would need to have better assurance that there's broader buy-in to how to question about whether to use it and how to use it and how to structure that resolution. And so some sort of supermajority vote requirement of the board probably would be important to assure both you today and future boards of the DRCOG that they're going to be able to, that they're really going to get to a solution that they, that a strong majority of the board agrees to.
Any other questions?
I just wanted to thank you, Tammy, for talking a little bit. I think every county, every one of the sub-regional forums has kind of seen this happening and tried to maybe get on the leading edge of it. And I just wanted to offer, again, for transparency and also for maybe consideration, is that what our technical team recommended to the sub-forum's executive team is that we bypass talking about whether we would opt in or, so what they posed to us was the theoretical proposition that if money was available, how would we split it? So they've moved on beyond deciding whether or not a regional, local taxing decision is being made, but getting ready to decide how we would allocate the funds helped us get to that point where we were finding ourselves in some agreement without tackling the most difficult part of that whole question, which is, do we ask the voters or do we try to do our own thing? So I just offer that for your enjoyment and consideration.
Any other questions or comments?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Real quick. So thank you all very much. This is very useful for us, and I hope you got something out of this discussion as well. So a few things that I've heard that we'll kind of chase down and get some additional information for you all. One is related to the opt-out concept. Is that, as currently drafted, sufficient? And if not, we'll have that conversation with the drafter. And talk about that. This, the concept of the supermajority, the words are in the in the bill, but we're not quite sure what it actually means. So we'll get some clarification on that. Ron mentioned in his earlier remarks about the hold harmless and the idea of getting federal in there as well as state funding the CDOT controls. I think when he mentioned that, there was a lot of head nods. So we'll explore that option. A couple other things regards to governance. Have a conversation about that, and maybe some anxiousness about, you know, the kind of the open-ended nature of the current bill, the way that it's written. Equity of funds, I think that's something else that, you know, I'd like to at least have a conversation with Representative Gray or somebody about that, because I know, you know, ultimately we want to make sure that we're equitable in that funding and in the funding streams. Those are the things that I have. Are there anything else that you'd like us to explore?
Director Pfeiffer said to kind of discuss with other MPOs just to take their temperature. It sounds like we did once. Maybe a second phone call would probably.
I just want to make sure what else is out there. It's like the 109-110 issue. I suspect there's something out there that the other, and Elise is correct, that the rural areas and the counties are very much object this totally. They think it's a DRCOG bill. So those other TPRs are banding together and proposing different stuff. So I think it's best that you reach out because the electeds of these TPRs are talking about not supporting it. So I get you talking to staff and executive directors, but understand the electeds are the ones who are pushing back now.
Yeah. Oh, definitely. We will reach out.
Yeah. Anything, Director Partridge?
Yeah. Thank you, Derek. Do we know if either RTD or CDOT will take a position on this bill? Do we know?
Director Rogers, I don't know. I haven't heard from either of those agencies.
Director Brockett?
Are you going to be asking the board for a position on this bill once it gets fully fleshed out?
Yes.
Interesting discussion.
Will be indeed.
But isn't it the next meeting?
Well, potentially. You know, it seemed timely just simply because the hearing's occurring on March 4th. But you know, at your pleasure, of course. I mean, if you don't feel we're ready, don't do it.
Maybe you can take some time and come back with some answers at our next meeting, and then comfortable we can discuss it. If not, we can always continue it or just...
Guess I would portray it, and I've used this term a lot for those who've been around a while, is I would certainly ask for board direction. In other words, you'll have the conversation about you could have an up or down vote on support or oppose, but certainly I would hope that the board would want to stay at the table in these conversations. And so I'm going to certainly be looking for ultimately some direction as the lobbyist how to go forward and talk to legislators about this.
Is there anybody on the phone who has any questions or comments? Anybody here? Oh, I'm sorry, Director Brown.
I guess just if we were going to be asked to weigh in at the next board meeting, there are a lot of unanswered questions here. I mean, we've shown a lot of interest in potential changes or adjustments, and I don't know if this going to be passed potentially on the first hearing, or is there, could we maybe wait a month and see how it develops?
That would probably be sort of that discussion we'd have in February, and maybe that monitor position would probably come into play.
Okay.
Again, I think that's...
And we will ask those questions, too.
Director Atchison.
This will be the first hearing. It's in the House. Still has to get out of the House and then go to the Senate. So the option to positions on it are just starting. And any changes will be through multiple readings in both houses of potential changes to that. And then if there are changes, it has to go back to the House or back to the Senate to get confirmation of those changes. So this is just starting on the process.
Rich?
At the risk of throwing another wrench into this, I had this come up in other years. I also think ahead about, well, if something does eventually move, once it does move, it could move very quickly, and it could be changed multiple times along the way. So then I'm going to also be wondering what's my direction as your lobbyist on how to react to those changes. We don't necessarily have a position or a place for those kinds of quick of a board meeting, and then we take a position, or I get direction, and a week later something big changes. Do I or Doug or Ron, do we have enough direction to move forward on something?
If I might, I mean, so for instance, if there was agreement among the board that, you know, maybe you support the bill, but only if it's amended in certain ways, mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. specify those, at least that gives direction to Rich to talk to the bill sponsors and others about advocating for those specific amendments that would be required for Dr. Cog to actually be supportive of the bill.
That would be helpful, and the board has, other boards have done this in the past, actually on transportation bills, even kind of outlined basic principles that any bill would have to meet. You could outline specific changes to the bill that and you can decide on that basis, but that kind of direction would be helpful.
So I was talking to Executive Director Rex. I think in the past we've had, for fast-moving bills, we've had the board give some latitude to either the executive
committee. Yeah, 1242, I know we did something.
Or the chair, vice chair, something like that. So there'll be options, I guess, we can address at that point in time. Any other questions, comments? All right, I think we're done.
Thank you.
Next item, proposed 2050 Metro Vision Regional Transportation Plan Scenario Outcome Measures. Jacob Rieger, coming to the podium as we wait.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Jacob Rieger, DRCOG's long-range transportation planning manager. So first of all, I don't know how to follow that, so I'll just do my best. But hopefully this will be a little bit of a change of pace and something interesting from your last conversation. So topic for today, as you all know, we are in the midst of preparing our big regional long-range Metro Vision Regional Transportation Plan. Our current plan is our 2040 plan, and we're in the midst of doing this major update to our 2050 plan. So many of you have seen this slide before. It's just kind of a reminder of our overall process. It's a lot of moving parts, a lot of things going on. So this is a little bit of a simplification. But in a nutshell, we started work last year, reaching out to the public, stakeholders. We came to your forums, getting as many voices involved as possible to just kind of hear about, where are people at, what's important to people, what do they care about, what's working, what's not, to sort of set that foundation for the planning process. We're in phase two right now. Where we're talking about scenario analysis, and that's what we're going to spend some time on today. And then we'll move into developing the plan and reviewing and adopting the plan later this year and into early 2021. So specifically regarding the scenario analysis process, you'll recall at your December meeting as the full board, you endorsed the proposed scenario concepts that we brought to you. I have a slide in a second, just a reminder of what those scenarios are. And we said that based on that endorsement, we are starting to test those scenarios, but we also wanted to start a conversation about how do we make sense of the results that we're going to get from the scenarios. So again, just specifically on the scenario process, again, that phase one public engagement, what's important to people about our transportation system. The second box, we've been preparing our tools and our forecast, 2050 land use forecast, very robust land use and traffic modeling tools that we'll use in this work. And then we are here in the third box of actually testing. We've just started testing these scenarios. Once we get results, how do we make sense of those results? And then finally, how do we use that information to prepare the 2050 Regional Transportation Plan? So these are the scenario concepts that you endorsed at your December meeting. I won't go through them in great detail here, except to make a couple points. One is that these concepts together really encompass all aspects of our multimodal transportation system, and that's on purpose. It's not about an individual scenario. Do we like an individual scenario or dislike an individual scenario? The idea is that when you put all of these together, we're really testing and exploring all aspects of the regional transportation system. And we want to do that on purpose to understand, when we try A, B, and C, and X, Y, and Z happens, to understand those relationships. So just really briefly, we have a scenario that focuses on transit service investment. One that's really about urban arterials, travel choices, complete streets, safety, that kind of scenario. One about technology, connected and autonomous vehicles, other aspects of technology affecting mobility. One that looks at regional highways and operations. One that looks specifically at our freeways and interstates and looks at sort of off-peak congestion. What would it take to mitigate or address off-peak congestion on the region's freeways? And then finally, the scenario, regional jobs, housing balance, this is really getting at the idea of, when we look at where people live and where people work and other places that we go throughout our day, what would happen on a regional scale if we could bring some of that closer together? How would that change regional traffic patterns? All of those are compared against a baseline, and that baseline is our existing adopted 2040 Metro Vision Regional Transportation Plan. So some people like words, some people like pictures. The bottom line here on this is that this is really sort of a exploratory exercise, and I want to be clear that, and I have a slide on this, we're not choosing projects, we're not making financial plan decisions just yet. What we're doing is really exploring these relationships between land use and urban form, transportation system approaches that you just saw outlined in the six or seven scenarios, and what those do, separately and really together to influence travel and mobility patterns. People say, well, what if we just did this? Okay, well, let's test that. What happens on the back end when you do that? Or what if we tried this strategy? Okay, let's try that. Let's see what happens. Does that resonate? Does that move the needle? So it's really this exploratory exercise. So just to be a little more clear about that, we really are exploring what-if alternative futures, and these are very distinct. It's not that one of these particular scenarios would come true or should come true. This is that we want to have something really distinct so that we can see differences between each of them when we compare them together to each other, when we potentially, you know, combine a couple of them if we can get there in the work, to see how they respond. So it's exploring those what-if alternative futures. These are relative comparisons between the scenarios and the baseline, and I want to be clear about that. This is not an absolute, this is good, this is bad, this performs well, this performs poorly. It's not that kind of exercise. We're not choosing a scenario. We're not choosing a hybrid of scenarios. As I said, we're not choosing projects directly off this work. So I want to reassure you, the point here is about, again, you'll probably get sick of me saying this, it's about exploring those relationships between land use and transportation, not about making a particular decision about a particular thing. It's not a rigorous evaluation of scenarios. So in this conversation, I want to frame this a little bit. You know, we all sort of default to like scenario evaluation. I've caught myself saying that. We're really assessing the outcomes of the scenarios. Again, we're not choosing a scenario. We're not something whether it's good or bad. But this is really about, hey, this scenario does these three things here, and maybe these other things over here. This scenario does this thing, these things here, and these things way over here. How do we make sense of that? We know that each of these scenarios is going to sort of ping or respond to certain things. You know, just to state the obvious, the transit scenario, you know, probably is going to respond well in transit ridership, may not respond well in some other things. The technology scenario will do some things over here, you know, respond really well and maybe not so well in some other things. So when you put all that together, how do we make sense of that? And that's really the conversation. And that really gets to the sort of the second to last bullet. Implicit in these scenarios is, you know, choices and trade-offs over time. We probably can't be good at everything, even though we want to try. You know, we'll do well in some things, not so well in other things. How do we, you know, what ultimately is important to us? Are we willing to do A, B, and C if it means we can't do D, E, and F? You know, it's that kind of conversation, ultimately providing guidance and direction for how we put the plan together. So let's start talking specifically about how do we start making sense of the results of these scenarios once we get them. A lot of color on this slide, but let me sort of summarize the bottom line. What you're seeing on this slide is the specific performance targets, performance measures in our Metro Vision plan. And these are listed over on the left here, and then over on the right are the directly transportation-related sort of performance targets from Metro Vision. And you've seen some of this from me before. Sort of our punchline on the transportation side is that when you look at those six measures on the right of where we say that we want to be in Metro Vision by even 2040, much less 2050, you know, one or two of them we're kind of doing okay so far. But frankly, most of them we're not there yet. The trend is not where Metro Vision says that we want to be. So the point here is that we think a starting point, not the ending point, but a starting point for assessing scenario outcomes should be what we've already said in Metro Vision, what this region wants to be when it grows up in 2040 and 2050. So that's really these sort of measures here on the left. Again, that's a starting point. In the work that we already do in our transportation model and in our regional transportation plan, we have a whole set of quantitative sort of results, quantitative outcomes that we can get from our regional traffic model. And I'm not going to go through all of these individually here today. I know it looks a little overwhelming on the screen, but this is actually a sort of chop up or a mashup of table 7.1 in our existing 2040 Metro Vision regional transportation plan. These are sort of the common outcome assessments that we do every time that we prepare or amend a regional transportation plan. And again, without going through them individually, it's all the things that you would expect around vehicle miles of travel, transit ridership, average person delay per trip. You know, there's a whole set of measures, quantitative measures that we can get out of our model that help us tell the story about what's happening on an individual scenario. In the lower right of this slide, I will point out a couple things. One of the things that we do in our regional transportation planning and that we've been asked to do, some of the input that we've gotten to get us to this point was the issue of sort of equity and transportation disadvantaged populations. You know, how do we address those or think about those? So those measures on the lower right are really about transit jobs, access to work, both for the region and then for our sort of transportation disadvantaged populations or minority, low-income, veteran-type populations. So those we propose to include as well, as we typically do in our transportation planning process. What about some other things that we've heard getting to this point about what's important about how we assess scenarios? Some things that we've heard either from the public, from you, from the county forums, from other stakeholders, planning level scenario cost estimates. We did this the last time that we did scenario analysis 5 or 6 years ago. We were already planning to do this again, but we've heard, you know, hey, can you cost out these scenarios? And to be clear, these are not project engineering level cost estimates. They're, to use Ron's phraseology, they're in the neighborhood of the ballpark of what a scenario would cost. But again, relative comparisons between scenarios, not absolute comparisons. The idea here is that we would do a planning level cost estimate of each of the scenarios because it helps in that choices and trade-offs conversation. You may like, you know, particular scenarios outcomes. If that scenario costs, you know, $1 billion more than the next scenario, is that trade-off worth it? So it's, you know, it's part of informing that conversation. Growth and development trends. You know, sort of that land use side of the equation is obviously really important. Safety, you know, I don't need to iterate how important safety is. Safety is not a direct output of our traffic model, but there's things that we think we can do to tell a story about safety in each of these scenarios. One of the other things we heard, human service transportation, so transportation for some of our disadvantaged populations. Again, not a direct output from our model, but, you know, let's, again, not forget that, that sort of part of the equation. We think we can do some things to sort of estimate that as part of our scenario outcomes. One of the things we heard when we brought this to our Transportation Advisory Committee, they were very supportive of this, but one of the specific comments they had for us was sort of the environment side of the equation, resiliency, you know, don't forget those measures, you know, can we bring some of those in? Greenhouse gas emissions is one of our Metro Vision targets. So there's that. And then the last one that I have up here I think is very important. You know, you've seen a lot of, you know, sort of number-centric things on here. That's certainly important. But part of this assessment of outcomes of scenarios we think is qualitative as well. Each of these scenarios is really a story about a particular version or vision of the future. So in thinking about the results of that scenario, when we start putting scenarios together, we think there's a qualitative story to be told. We may not know what it is standing here today just yet until we see some of those results, but really I would just suggest to you that the results are not just quantitative, but there's a qualitative storytelling element as well. And so with that, let me just come back to this slide and really just ask, you know, does this resonate with you? Does this seem like we're on the right track? And are there other things that you'd like us to consider as we start getting results from scenarios and start assessing them? Before I open it up to questions and conversation, just to give you a sense of what's ahead, again, at your December meeting, you endorsed these concepts, gave us the go-ahead to start testing. We're just starting that process now. We'll be doing that over the next couple, 3 months. So in the springtime is when we anticipate coming back to you with some initial results, and we'll use this framework to help you make sense of what we think those results are saying. And with that, I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Questions or comments? Is Jacob on the right track?
Looks good.
See, head nods.
Jacob's always on the right track.
I appreciate that. I think that's a question for my wife and kids, but I appreciate the positive.
Jacob, aren't you on like the regional train type thing? So I'm sorry for the pun.
Front range,
sorry.
I happen to be the vice chair of the Southwest Chief and Front Range Rail Commission.
Sorry about that.
Yeah, Mr. Dyack, that's a different show.
Yeah.
It's a different show.
All right.
Different day.
Thank you. All right. Sounds good. Looks like we're no questions, comments. You're on the right track. There is nothing else. We're adjourning this thing at 5:25. Thanks for coming.
So performance and engagement committee members, so we'll reconvene in, say, 10 minutes in Douglas Fir, which is the room right next door.